come get you some. Say it again, say, come get you some.
Come get you some.
Say to me, say, Ben, come get you some. This is just for me, not just for you, not just for your neighbor, not for everybody else, it's for everyone. And I want you to know, God is shaking some things up. God is shaking some things up, and we always pass them. That's the thing, is we act like this is something new because we got away from it. But he's always been trying to shake things up in our lives. And into the last, since 2020, last couple of years, over a couple of years, God has been shaking things up. There's been a lot going on. There's been a lot going on. But the reason God does that is because he wants to be shaking you up, me up, our church up, our world up, because he wants to bless you out of some boundaries that you placed on yourself. Some limitations, some ceilings, some low expectations that you have set up for in the way you live and what you believe for. And God shakes us up. And we have to twist the cap for it to bust out. And that's not just what happens in this room. That's what's supposed to happen in your family, in your relationship with God, in everything you do, in every season. God shakes us up. The things that don't make any sense in your life the last 2 years, the people you've taken God to, he is shaking you up, and you've got to twist the cap. And that has church, we are going to twist the cap. Because I refuse to get up there and preach to you and have my own limitations that I placed on myself. God shake us up. Can you do this right now? Online music, some of you should be here right now. Wait for this for me. How do you do that on the beach? If you're on fall break, that's cool too. I get that. God wants to be shaking you up for a reason. That's what he's doing. But this frustration that our culture is in, it is not the time for frustration. It is not the time to be preaching on end times and talking about it all the time. That is not, it is not the time for that. Every major move of God, every revival, every testimony that has happened or will happen is set up by a season of struggle that does not make sense. But they got done something that we didn't see coming, but we did. Every one of them. Every one of them. Because I want the world falling apart. That was not checking things up. And you can either twist the cap, or you can let the Lord explode on it. But God is shaking things up. He is shaking things up. Every one of us. And it's not just what he's saying, God. It's not just what he did then, or what he did now, or what he did. It's what he wants to do in this season, this moment, in your life. Nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. God wants to do that right now. He wants to do things in your family, in your faith, in every part of it. Right now, he is shaking you up. The things that are stretching you out, the things that are tearing your marriage apart, the things that are tearing your relationship with your kids apart, your finances apart. God is shaking things up. And we either unscrew the cap or we don't. But God is moving in this place. And I want you to know, I went Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. It's decade day, right? I went Fresh Prince of Bel-Air with my outfit, but I'm about to go Phil Collins on y'all. It's in the air, y'all. And if you're a kid and don't know what that song is, I feel bad for you. Something is happening here. There is something happening here, and it's the thing is, it's just you're aware of it. God's doing something in your life, but are you aware of it? There's something happening, and God is moving. So if the news says, come get you some. You can come get you some or not. God's going to turn anyway, God's going to move anyway, but we are going to get up some. And God shook up my entire message plans this week. Last week he did it, and I wrote like three of them before I settled on what I was going to do. But I'm going to tell you what we're going to do as a church. And some people may not want to go with us. Because I know that every level of growth, every level of growth in your life happens in church and everything. There's people that aren't going to go to the next level with you, and people that are. But all I know is God has done something in my heart for about 2 months, and it finally got some clarity. We got to do this, or we don't. But God's doing it. God's moving it. Come get you something. He's taking things up. He's doing something. So I want to preach to you today my outline, my message. I overthought preaching, my message, my outline, my points, my scripture is what we are going to focus on. Because God and sons in this place, we ain't saying nothing yet, but we're going to do it the right way, and we are going to focus on Him no matter what happens. And we are going to renew our focus today. So I want you to have complete clarity on where we're going. You're not beginning to pay much attention, but if you've been here for very long, you see that God's doing something, and we are going to focus on the presence and power of God. Period. And if you want it, I'm going to get you something. Yeah. Again? What's it say? I'm going to be here. And this is nothing new. This is nothing new. The New Testament church, this is what they focused on. This was normal for Jesus. This was the focus of Jesus. I'm going to prove it to you. The presence of God, by Jesus told his disciples. But I tell you the truth, it is better for you that I go away. It's better for me to leave you, because if I leave it, because we love that. It's better for me that I go, but my tears are out. You know, Peter said, no, you have to go to the cross, all that stuff. And Jesus says, no, what you don't realize is better if I go away. Because if I go away, I can send a helper, and then have the Holy Spirit, the power and presence of God, my power inside of you. If I do not go away, the helper will not come. See, what we're going to celebrate on Christmas, and I have a tendency for that too, is that Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. That is His heart, and that is so much hope in that. And it's going to be beautiful in December. But my focus in December will also be what I'm telling you today, which is that we say that. It's better because Jesus says, I'm leaving. It's better I go because I am located because I'm not just going to be God with you, I'm going to be God in you. I'm not leaving. It's going to take some faith on your behalf, God. But my power and presence is going to live in you, and I'm going to use you. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to do some things in you. I'm going to give you a testimony. I'm going to blow your mind. The Bible says the same Spirit that lived in Jesus, the same power that raised Him from the dead, lives in you. He's not just the same God, it's the same power. And Jesus told His disciples, they didn't like it. It was uncomfortable for them, but He said, I am leaving. And it's better that I go because I'm sending something more powerful because I'm not just going to be with you. I'm going to be picking up and blowing your mind if you stay focused on it. In the American church, we like the whole table, sit in a chair, have some right conversations. That ain't what Jesus did. That ain't what Catholics did. Jesus said, it's better that I go because I'm going to keep. That's still true. That's still true. That's still true. Jesus said Himself, He said, I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me, tell somebody next to you, said, that's all the prerequisite. You can even do it yourself in grammar, like I just said, that's all the prerequisite. I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done. The same works, what? Remember what Jesus did? Yeah, He raised the dead, he healed families, He brought people back to Jesus. Good God. He literally kissed everybody off and got crucified for him, and He didn't kiss people off because of ego. He chose where He was going to be unpopular when Jesus based on pride. He chose to make based on people. He said, you will do the same works. He said, you will do the same things, Father, if we're not doing that, we are not really living in them. I'm talking to myself in this church right now. Not just you, me. Anyone who believes in me will do the same works I've done and even greater works. You better say it's like, greater things! Greater things! Greater things in your family! Greater things in your kids! Single mothers and single daddies and single grandparents! Greater things in your mind! You have been walking! You have been walking in rooms! You've been coming to church for years! But you still walk in a room with anxiety and depression and feeling inferior! Say, greater things! Jesus said, greater things will you do. Greater things will I chose you. I will do them in you and through you. This is what He told His disciples. And nothing has changed. The same gospel. Greater. You've made some mistakes. Lost some years. Had like 17 marriages. It's still true. Greater things. Greater things. You got married at like 50 because you blew your life away and had to rebuild it. It's still true. 50, 60, 70, 90, 90, greater things.
Come on, man.
Greater things. Jesus said, greater things will, even greater ones, because I'm going to be with the Father, a relocate inside of you. I'm not just with you. I'm still with you. But I'm in you too. Greater things. That is why the Apostle Paul could tell the messed up, dysfunctional, and human only. These are some of the things that seminary taught me that I'm so grateful to read. Corinth was so messed up, and he still told them, he said, you have everything you need. And I'm telling you, man, so many years messed up with the same type of messed up as them. Nobody, I can tell you that for sure, because these jokers were messed up. I got time to talk about it. Your kids probably don't want to hear it. They should be bad kids. You're probably going to really, really, really never come back and tell them you don't live right here. Great. You have everything you need. The power and presence of God. That promise that Jesus said that I'm going and relocating happened in what we call the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2. It was a very awkward, especially for the American church movement. It was very awkward, but very authentic. And an authentic offer, because God is always pushing boundaries. And as soon as you, I tell you about 90% of the things that we're uncomfortable with, God is ready for us to come by, not the right for us. There's some things that may be uncomfortable, like for your safety and for your toxic things in your life, but those are the things that you're uncomfortable. I don't know about that. You probably need to question your motive, because God is a God of, He's not faith as a family comfort. I'll get to that in a minute. This day we call Pentecost. Everybody preaches on the cross. Nobody preaches on Pentecost. They're not here. Not this country. But that was the promise where the presence of God fell in the church. And it says on that day, and it's still true, it says, and everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit. Say everyone. Say me. I want you to speak it over your neighbor. I want you to speak it over yourself. Say me. Everyone. Everyone who was in that room, in the upper room, seeking His presence, every one of them, every one of them experienced the presence of the power of God. Not one did. The only people that did were outside the room when they fell and never thought about this is weird. They're drunk. They're like, it's not drunk. It's too early for that. The drunks are still in bed. We're doing something. God's doing something here. Everyone. You've been speaking blessing over everybody else. You can see potential and promise and blessing in other people's lives. You can learn to encourage everybody else. But God said, when the presence of God fell, it fell on everyone. I don't care what your learning disabilities are. The presence of God is the only reason you joke like me with all the disabilities, learning disabilities, diagnosis, is the craziness of my brain. I'm not letting myself down because it's a testimony. I'm very confident and comfortable with my skin because I know that the only reason I can stand up here and make a lick of sense on good days is because of His presence. Because everybody, I can walk into rooms with some of the wealthiest people in this county, and I usually wouldn't say a word. If I got a question, I'll get this stupid. I won't ask them because I realize God's got plans for me. His promise is for everyone. That is what happened on Pentecost. And if it's not happening in our lives, day to day, season to season, glory, glory, faith to faith, you're missing something. Oh, hallelujah. You can love Jesus, but if you're not experiencing Him every day and every moment, you're missing something. Because we like to preach on what Jesus did, but we don't like to preach on what He's doing. We love talking about, thank you, God, for the cross. But what about the empty grave of Pentecost where He said, I'm happy, I'm not just with you. We all get nostalgic on Christmas, but I don't preach on Pentecost, man. What do you have to do? This was the norm for them, huh? Don't get you something like that. I don't know what it's going to look like. I don't know that it's definitely going to be different for me than for you because my testimony is different. Yours is, but yours matters, mine matters, because Jesus said it as He said, everyone. Amen. Everyone who wanted some, got some. Everyone who was hungry for it, got it. It looked different parts of the person. Their giftings, their abilities, their influence, what they went out of Jerusalem and did with it was different, but everyone, Paul said. So I said, this is normal, Paul said to the Galatian church, a church he planted. And so I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Some interpretations say, be led by the Spirit. This which was the goal, I believe. The goal wasn't getting saved. The goal wasn't coming to the altar and just making an intention for what I've done yesterday. The goal was, I am committing and I am focused on what he's doing every day of my life. Being led by the Spirit, he says, then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. If you will begin to teach him, he says, being led by the Spirit, one is not being led by your insecurities for your social media posts and likes and shares and all that stuff. That's a drug. We need to talk about that. It's a drug. It's where does your brain the same thing as the drug that's not proxies. You're doing it by how many likes and shares you get based on your work on that. We got to do it. Being led by the Spirit is not being led by what your parents did to you or what your ex did to you trying to prove yourself. It's not being led by your insecurities and your anger and your anxiety. Being led by the Spirit is being led by the Spirit. You will pray what's behind you. You will pray what's before you and what's forward. Because we come to church and we think that we got to come back to Jesus. No, Jesus has been here the whole time. He's been waiting on you to come get yourself. I'm telling you, I'm preaching from a place of repentance myself because there were several years that I was up there preaching about it, but I wasn't doing it myself. And COVID took the carpet out from under me and said, boy, do you remember what made that broken boy like you with Jesus and what made you not just decide to follow me but experience me? You better get back to it. Come get you something, Bob. Nothing. Nothing has changed. This was normal to them. This was normal. The world is not falling apart. Nothing has changed. He is shaking things up, and we get to choose where we're going to focus. Because I'm going to tell you, we're focused on his power and his presence. Because the Bible says the place is real. Amen. The Spirit is willing. We're not even going to read the scripture, place like a textbook. Because that will kill him. The Spirit is life. It's always the case. And we see this on the disciples after Pentecost. Because I want to see what you did at the altar. I don't want to see one Sunday from me. I want to see what you did after the altar. The reason that I won't let certain people do certain things in leadership until they're ready is because I don't care what you can do from a stage. I don't care what you can do in a classroom. I don't care if you quote the scripture better than me. I want to see what you do after. And so what you see, and that's why I see the damage that is done by the abusers. Power, because we can say we're taking the power of God, but really we're just taking power, and then we can take the stuff that is not the power of God. But you see in the New Testament, the power of God, the presence of God, all over the Bible. But what is Acts chapter 4? Peter and John, who were very, very outside of the comfort zone. Peter was a fisherman, he probably couldn't read or write. God said, it's true. He's talking about somebody like that before in 1st and 2nd Peter. There are a lot of scholars that believe he was a literate to the day now. Peter and John are facing the Jewish council. That is a very educated, elite group of people. They actually did a miracle, a hell person, and they're actually facing charges for it. We're doing good things. By the way, your book, you think you got drama when you did the wrong thing, and you got big money, you got money, you got way too much stuff turning around and doing the right thing. You know, I'm not the one who wants to say this. Wait till you stop going to the club every weekend and see what happens. Wait till you tell them, man, I can't do that for you anymore, man. It's up to you. I love you, but you got to make some choices for yourself. You just wait till you start actually coming to church every Sunday and bringing your family. You just wait till you see what happens when you do right. Peter and John killed a man and had to go to jail for it. Wait till the drama gets as far as up a little bit, you just want to deal with it better than that good job. They face something. Peter was their enemy, said this about him. The Jewish council, the same thing, said this about him. About them. They said that they were amazed at their courage because they were ordinary, uneducated men, but they took note that they had been with Jesus. His presence, his power was all over them. When only those people would eventually kill them, but they couldn't stop the movement because what they said was the truth. The presence of God was all over them. Peter, you go there on a mat, there are people laying in the street trying to just get Peter shadowed upon something. You know why? They drain something. Are people drawing you or they drain like that? You come to church where you turn your hands up in the air, and why do you come to church consistently? I applaud you for that because we live in a culture we're trying to show people the importance of being in a room with them because that matters too. people drunk with you? Do they run with you? Do they get drunk with you or point to you when they actually need some solid, clear counsel? Or do they run with you and get drunk when they're running away from something? Because I'm telling you, with Peter, these jokers are trying to find the shadow. Because they couldn't get to him because a lot of other people were there trying to find the shadow. The presence and power of God was all over.
Amen.
Paul gets stoned. By the way, you don't get up from getting stoned. He did. He got up. You know what he did? He get up and get stoned. He went back into the city that stole him, preaching the gospel. Not fear, not taking shots at them. He went back to preach the presence of God that was normal to him. That is power. That is what the presence of God looks like. Man, I'm awkward anyway. I got this. I'm weak. You're awkward, your own version of awkward and weird and crazy. But they were unafraid, and the presence and power of God was all over them. Paul and Silas, man, they got illegally beaten to death, or beaten after that. It's illegal what was happening to them. By the way, when somebody tries to make up with something like that, they can say, we were put down. I'm not talking about them out there, I'm talking about you and me. We are prideful people. And these jokers illegally get beaten for loving Jesus, and they are in a jail cell. And the Bible says they were praising God, but it doesn't say they were just praising God instead of about midnight, which means they were praising God the last 5 minutes, it's midnight hours. If you were praising God at midnight, then you were praising at 10 and 9 and 8 and 8 and you're beating them now, you're beating after that. Severe injuries. And at midnight is when the train broke loose and the jail cell busted open. And you know what they did? They didn't run. Because when they run out of the day, this is the power of the presence of God. You want to see on your life? Here it is. They run out the jail cell, but they don't run away. They see that the God is about to kill himself. Because if he loses his prisoners that they don't like because they're Christians, he's going to die anyway. So he's about to fall on the sword. And Paul and Silas have so much of the presence of God, they say, hold up, don't kill yourself. That night they ran him and his entire family and had dinner with him. I'm going to tell you something, y'all. That is what the Bible says. You don't kill with the people that go different. You don't even look at the people that turned on you and betrayed you. You don't sit there and chill and wish the folks on. They ran out of the cell and didn't run away. They ran to them. Power present all over them. Stephen died with a smile on his face. The first person was healed for loving Jesus. You talk about how the Republicans are all about to get you, and how Democrats and Republicans are trying to take my wife's skin. They got everything taken from them. And Stephen got his wife taken from them. In the Bible, don't read that story. If it doesn't move you, you're gone. You need to work on yourself. When God would chose you to smile because it was connected to his Father, to Jesus. Power, presence of God. It was all over them. And it was because they came and got it, they wanted it. Nothing has changed. Everyone, something's real. Yeah. Your spouse. If you get to, is that the top? Or don't. But God offers it to everyone. His presence, his power. Won't you quit fighting so many battles when you're only trying to prove that you're wrong, see his presence? That's hard to do. Red crowns are practiced, right? All over them. By the way, there were people just like right here that don't deny the power of God. Paul tells Timothy, they will act religious. Woo! Woo! I'm good at that! If I put up some scriptures and thoughts that they're ridiculous, it's ridiculous, it's actually why I can do that with the best of them. They act ridiculous because they reject me. You better turn it off. You didn't say power.
Power!
That can make them God. You didn't say the information in the scripture that can make them God. You didn't say going to church that can make them God. You didn't say talking the talk that said they did not have the power that can make them God. They were doing it then, we're doing it now. Because we do not like inconvenience, we do not like being uncomfortable, we do not like confronting our feelings and our fears, and being honest with everybody, all the power we feel, we like pretending. We might say that power doesn't exist. We call it crazy. We push people away. We change the subject when we don't want to talk about it. We turn it around ourselves when we don't want to talk. When we don't want to actually commit to Jesus, it's about us. It's my birthday. It's my day. It's my best. It's my bad. And then before you go, you can just do it on your birthday. You do it on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and every decision you make. Oh, it's like a circle. It's like a circle. But we deny the problem. Oh, that's crazy. I don't want none of that. Well, we don't have a casual, superficial relationship with the Bible. But I'm going to tell you, in Catholic Church, we are not staying safe, and we are not staying focused. Because Jesus did die to make you safe and focused. He died to shake you off and set you loose. And if you want some, tell somebody, say, come and get some. Because that's what he wants. You don't get it from me. You don't get it from the surface. You get it from him. What we're doing here is trying to host it. You can see us. We're trying to make changes in the way we do service and the way we do announcements. Because when you're seeking God, we want it to be about you. We want to create space. If that means eliminating announcements, I don't know what it is. You're seeking, you can see the seat is different. We are trying in every way to make it about him. Because that's what he wants to do, is blow your mind. Nothing has changed except for us. So let me just go ahead and draw the line. You can pretend, but every season I think there was some type of moment that I said, go ahead and watch it. We are going to pretend things different. We are going to believe that we're going to play tough. What's your attention? Because he's been back in there. He's back to set you loose and check you up, trying to check you. It's like, come to Jesus. Obedience. How many times have you heard this scripture preached in churches all around, from the Sunday school teacher? Jesus said, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We love to talk about that. Why? Well, we don't focus on the next verse, and I got it underlined or capitalized in your notes. Teach these new disciples to what? Obey. We don't like obedience. We like to, we put out about obeying something. We're a disobedient culture. We went the other direction. We went from complaining to absolutely rebellious. Teach the disciples to obey all the commands. Everything I told them. To trust me. To obey me. That's what I'm saying. I've given you everything. Which all the things I've given you. And make sure that I'm with you always, even until the end. You know why God has important blessing in your life? You love Jesus, you give him some blessings, but you know why he has important blessing in your life? It's because you don't know what he says, you don't really walk in his ways. You may get the appearance of doing it, but you don't really do it, and all of us struggle with this. You don't trust him enough to do what he says. Jesus told his disciples, who sent them out? Could you imagine getting sent out to a bar and stuff on one another? He sends them out and he said, don't take anything with you. Don't take anything with me. Why do you get trapped? Why would you not get so well? I didn't get the blessings of that Jesus. And even back then, no cell phone, water, a struggle. Don't take anything with you because you want them to know you don't need to get away from it. I don't want you to get slow down in the season because I want to meet you. Don't take anything with you. Don't take anything with you. And that's why. I don't like to say play around and get pissed off. They said nothing with them. Elijah? Let's go and watch up, excuse me. Man, burn his plows, and then barbecue his oxen when they cut it, and they dig all the way to ensure that he was going to go forward and not go back. We read these radical stories in the Bible, and we see that one thing, and we're like, what are you doing to me? But you don't trust me. You don't do what he says. I don't care what you say, I don't care what man says, I care what we do. We don't do what he says. Jesus told us, our relationship is built on trust. You don't do this, go into business with somebody you don't trust, and doesn't trust you. You don't marry them, and if you do, you're probably young and dumb and ain't going in with them. Say, my brother. You don't know what he said. He told the disciples the next morning, he said, hey, don't raise your hands, stay here. I'm going to tell you the spirit. I'm going to baptize you in fire. By the way, we love to preach fire as punishment in the scripture to control people, but fire is much more about purifying. It's the spirit of fire. expect that I'm going to function. I'm not going to read what Bible says in Scripture. He says, if you pray, you pray. He didn't say, get up and sit and pray. God says, I'll baptize you with fire. What did they do? Ask God and get dressed off and play around. Look at what he says. They're just waiting. 10 days later, the jumpers are waiting and worshiping God. They ain't trying to go run to a room. They're trying to pray and worship God. You know what they didn't know God said? God didn't want anything to say. They obey. Well, we can't even, well, we won't even be generous with our money, let alone actually trust God with our kids. It's all hard. We hold on to it. You make a tag, you don't. That's what you do. I want you to tell you, I care what you do. Jesus said, Jesus teaches us about those who put his teachings into practice, not just talking about them. The Pharisees talk about them. They talk about obedience. We make excuses. We make excuses. What are you not obeying God? Be honest with yourself. What are you not obeying God? What excuses are you making? Because I'm going to tell you. I'm going to tell you, there are some things in your life that need to go. Obedience is time to do that. You put it to the test, it's yours. There are some things in your life, oh, well. There are some things in your life that you need to twist it down. You need to overhaul, you need to do it now. There are some people you need to stop doing out there, some places that you need to stop going, some things and habits and mindsets you need to stop doing in heaven. Before you write down, you need to get some relationships. Every one of you need to either spend less time with some people or you need to spend no time with some people. Bible says bad company corrupts good character. I'm going to say that again for everybody who doesn't hear me, whether it's family or friends or people that drink you. Bible says bad company corrupts good character. Oh, come on, man. But you can love them since you're married, so we say the only way to love them is to be close to them. Paul 17, you love them from a distance, but you will not change them if you need to leave them, and it will change you if you do not leave them. I have had to learn the healing. If there's some people that I live for them, I have to heal by saying, I want you to find what God wants you to find. I want you to find it, but if they don't get my faith with you, you want to pray God, you just say, oh, if I love them, I'm supposed to die for them. That's my Jesus. Oh, please, that's it. That is my good. That's my reason. Jesus did it for us. We do it to prove ourselves. Don't pray. Your kids, no, you do it to prove yourself to them. You don't love your kids like Jesus. You don't see it, I promise you. And if you act like you do, you're taking this place. You need to change some things over and over again. Bible says this, I'm telling y'all, I know it sounds crazy, but poverty is a mindset, it is an habit, it's a posture. Poverty isn't something that just happens to people. It happens, but if you stay there, it's because you chose it. Bible says, good training and hard work lead to prosperity. But faith and shortcuts lead to poverty. I'm going to show you some things right now, because if you're obeying Jesus and you're staying stuck in poverty, it's because you're choosing poverty not obeying God. I'm going to give you a little dose from my life. You ready? I haven't told anybody. It's time to change it. I really need to change it a lot of stuff. But this happened to 15. I got 3 kids at the back. One person amen, because everybody else is like, oh, I don't want to go here. They love to come to the altar, but we really like making the changes that God said. If you trust me, you don't just come to the altar and give me attention and actually do it on Saturday. I look at my schedule. Church has been growing. I don't expect people in church that haven't been in church to know the work that it takes to serve more people like we've had for the last several months. I'm excited about it, but I was stressed out about it in June because we were not ready for the growth that we have today. I had too many meetings going on. I had too much work. My schedule was overpacked. And I'm good at it. pastors, anybody, how to get to the gospel. The gospel's not really have any room. I don't really think you can make excuses for darkness. Because I can do it. I can also drive you to keep the function. And so I can really, I can look at my schedule. I'll be honest with you. It was a lot easier to look at my schedule than Andy goes, do what I need, why don't you come in? 423 hours, I'll probably leave. I said, what do you mean? You know what I did? I have less meetings now. I actually had to change how much I met with some people. Some people, I've got a lot of meetings, a lot of new people, a lot of you on the road, and have a debate how often I can meet with you, because I know my limitations in the day. I know that I can get it done, but I can also get a ticket for every time I get a big time. I can hurt somebody with that. And so what I had to do is I had to say, you know what? That was fine. The same thought I preached to you the last year as we rebuilt this church, that was plot saying we have healed your name and trying to be free. So you know what? I've had some relationships that it helps more their feelings up and so I can be with you every week, give me one. I love you, I've been doing things that help me. It ain't you, it's me. That's the truth. Probably is a choice. Not just financially, emotionally, mentally, and I could have chosen for 5 minutes, 5 days to drive to the work, but me driving fast, I don't drive over 50 times since I was like 20. It was a lifestyle that I chose. So there's some things you're like, oh, I'm going to do this. Listen to me, don't be a slave to your schedule. Because if you don't manage your life, it will manage you. I don't care if you have 17 kids. If you can spend time with your marriage and with your spouse, you need to probably stop making some babies, but you can still do that. Come on. Stop making that now. Which one of you need to cut that right now? And this is just open and closed. But you can spend time with your marriage if you really want to. The one thing I've learned is whether you're broke or rich, whether you're a great church or a fancy church, whether you've got great kids or awful kids, the one thing I've learned is priorities will tell the tale. If you're overwhelmed by your schedule, it is not your busyness. If you're building life, you're going to be busy. If you're doing something with your life, you're going to be busy. But if you're overwhelmed by your schedule, that is not your problem, that is your excuse. That's your excuse. Your problem is priorities. Oh, you can buy some baby centers 2 months from now to go and go to the owner, buy two overnight trips, and you can save the money to go to Atlanta. Trust me, we did it. And now I can do it with, if I had the money I had as a single person before I married Andy, if we had that money now, I promise you, if you give me a budget, we will save the money to go spend time with each other. And if you don't, and your marriage falls apart, just know it was your choice. We blame God, but it's your choice. Can you manage your life or let it manage you? Because I'm telling you, if you will apply the principles of what Jesus said and do what he said with your marriage, you'll be improving instead of having conversations with your spouse. I love our online family. I love our online family. You work in the West Georgia area. If you don't come in here, you'll never come in here. You are not engaging. You will just receive your ministry. And you are part of this family, but your kids are not saying, come on. If you play it safe, that is not obeying Jesus. Pentecost started in the room. If it's right there, that's a whole other concern. It's started here. We don't obey. We don't obey. We don't do anything. Money, your paycheck is not your problem. Your budgeting and your wasteful spending is your problem. And your pay raise and a promotion won't fix it.
Come on, man.
It won't fix it. I'm not saying people, I have seen faithful people in this church that are so generous that have almost nothing to give. And I have seen God bless them because they trusted him. And I have seen people that are making the same great couple of two folks in Zachary, and guess who? I'm saying what God did, the people how they grew their financial, the people that are still getting raises, making six figures together, but they're spending six figures, that's poverty. Not what you make, what you do with it. There's a lot of caring people that get you good, but they don't do anything with it. Do you obey me? I'm going to say this last thing. I'm going to stop here because I'm going to move on because I'm going to start a conversation. I can't finish it with you. It's not my job to finish it, just to start. Smoke and cigarettes. teach that this was an inclusive church, an accepting church. We are. We should have this conversation in the back outside, but I have to kind of tell them to move because we've got people that got asthma go over there and smoke because we've got people that have asthma and they don't like it. I've had a lot of people out there like, I love you. All my smokers, I love you. I'm glad you come here smelling like cigarettes. I love my dogs. I'm glad you're doing it. But I'm also visiting the hospitals and I hear from the doctors that the most deadly thing we do in this country, it isn't what we eat, it isn't the opioid epidemic, it is smoking cigarettes. It is heart attacks in this country are significantly gone down, but in people's 20s, 30s, and 40s, they are going up regularly because that is how we handle stress. We smoke cigarettes. Tell the truth. And I've heard that in the council office with people. I got some people on leadership at this church. But they'll tell me, man, I'm going to quit. We've been talking about it 2 years now. I'll tell you too long. It ain't working. What you're doing ain't working. I know you want to, but obeying God is taking you want to do it. Although, if I'm wrong here, don't call me out and tell me to lie. But it bothers me. I grew up in a business, it bothers me to know in recovery groups. A lot of people are talking about how God is helping recover from addiction while smoking cigarettes constantly. To me, what it, I'm no expert, that's why I said, I'll bring you up and correct me later. It feels like if I was talking about my food addiction and I had little devils instead of big, or big news instead of little devils, that ain't much better. Cigarettes will, they take your, not just quantity, they take your quality. You can't even drink. I got people like, I just want to be able to breathe, like I'm saying, like I can work out. But if it ain't working out, it's going to get that. I'm seeing how pretty sprinkles of people that die from illness because they can't stop smoking. I've seen doctors tell people that I love that said, if you stop smoking, you'll have a long life and never have to stop smoking.
Come on.
Eat what you want, stop smoking. Doctors say that. What we did was, you love Jesus and I love you. In fact, smoking section, you get things and things, you get things, you get things, you get where y'all are coming here and we can deal with it, they don't even see them. You love Jesus, but you are planning your life around your next cigarette break. You think that's small. You're missing beautiful moments because you've got to go take a quick cigarette. We think we love to clean everybody else's stuff. We love to talk about the day people. That is a long conversation for a heterosexual male or woman.
Come on, preach it.
My gosh. Do you obey him? And do you obey when you're done? Because I got my dysfunction. So you're going to say, come on, I got it. You need to raise your hand right now. Because I got some stuff. Whether it's cigarettes or not, I got some stuff. Whether it's preaching or not, I got some stuff. Whether it's not being spent my money right, I got some stuff. And obeying God and trusting Him is how you experience Him. And we are going to focus on that season in this church. However much we grow or don't grow, if we explode or don't explode, if all you leave or not, I'm going to preach the empty seat. Presence and power of God, obedience. Let me leave you with this one little next point. In areas of your life you don't trust God, in the areas of your life you need to learn. I'll put that on social media page and you'll know I'm going to do that next week. The areas of your life that you don't trust God are the areas that you need to obey God. I'm moving around. I know I get some people hard, but that's it. But I have myself too. Thank you, Thank you. Want to get you something if you want it. If you want it, something you want to say on the surface, I ain't doing that. We ain't doing that. If we cut this church in half next week, we're going to go free with the people that come and trigger the cut in my hands. I promise I'll finish it. Faith and faithfulness. Faith and faithfulness. Bible says, and it is impossible to praise God without
faith.
Money? Yes? Faith. Anyone who wants to come to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who sincerely, by translation says, diligently seek Him. God is a rewarder of
faith.
And which means our focus should be on
faith.
Faith is prophesying to the dead bones like Ezekiel did. There's some things in your life that you may be dead, feel dead, that have been dead a long time, you don't even want to talk about because you don't think like your grandson. You better prophesy to the dead bones. That's faith. Faith is when the whole world and you're carrying the weight of the world on your shoulders and you feel like everything's against you, you say, God is for me, doing this work and against me. That is faith. That is faith. Faith is when they betray you and turn on you and try to make you the enemy. Faith is saying what Joseph said, that what you meant for hardly God meant for the good. That is faith. And we are going to focus on faith. I'm going to talk. If you don't see Tom the way he's leading this worship, he is, we're on our knees a lot more than Sunday. Our trap is going to be about faith. And the result of faith is faithfulness. The result of faith is faithfulness. If you have faith, you will be faithful. If you don't have faith, you won't be faithful. It is a fruit of faith. It is a result of faith. If you are flaking out my following with living, you need to be convinced that it's a faith problem. If you're not growing, and you're not growing, you've been coming to church for years, and you're doing the thing, or God's love, and like I'm doing good, but you're really not growing that much, that's a faith problem. We have faith, a conquering faith, a faith that God rewards, you grow. Paul told the Roman church, the Roman Christians, he said, we grow from faith to faith. Which means if you're not growing, you're losing faith. If you're letting people drain you and people take you from your faith and people hurt you and have to walk away from the church being God and everything that is good in life, you have a faith problem, not a people problem. Faith. He says he is a rewarder of faith. When they leave you, when the boss says hire you or promote you, and when they leave you, when terminal illness takes them out, and you gotta rebuild, you gotta take the pieces and start over. Faith. When the coach, all the young people in here, when the coach doesn't play you or when he cuts you, faith and faithfulness is doing it the right way. When the next team you or not, the next one will when you let God into doors and you put your life to go. Same with your adult parents who spank you for things they do with their jobs. You're trying to get the boss's attention, you're trying to get a man's attention, whether you're going to say your mama or say your daddy, you're trying to get everybody's attention. Come on, man. Faith and faithfulness. God rewards you. You want to twist the cap? You want to twist the cap? You want to take it off and let God bust out of the boundaries that you didn't think you would ever bust out of, the things in life you thought you would never see? You better have faith and faithfulness. And we are going to grow from faith to faith. Not just as a church, but as people, as your family. You're going to see it in me, because if you don't see it in me, that you won't do it in him. I see him. You think I get up here? I tell you, I work long hours. That's why when I just told you about my shortcuts and stuff in the speed ticket, I work long hours and have a lot of responsibility. I sleep probably less than most of you in this room. But the same God is a God of grief, but the God of grief, lastly, prayer.